Hi everyone, Annette from Miracle Baby's Newborn Nursery. Today I'm going to start a video step by step of how to paint a Preemie baby. So with me today I've got a little kit, Promise by Marita Winters. See its little face there? Obviously we'll see it more as we go along. Very sweet. Okay, so what you'll need to start off with is just your little dish, or you can use a paint palette, whatever is your preference. And what I do to that is add half a tablespoon of odorless thinners. Then with the odorless thinners, I'm going to add eyelid purple. I use one brush of eyelid purple. So one brush I class as a swipe on one side of the brush, turn it over and a swipe on the other side, and mix it into your odorless thinners. Then add some ultramarine blue. Again, one brush, so a swipe on one side and a swipe on the other side. Then mix it all in your little dish. As you can see there, it's a purpley blue, but it's a nice purple. Okay, so then what I want you to do is get a sea sponge. Mine is well used. I use mine over and over again. I normally use a purple color on that side, and then on the other side a flesh tone color. So I reuse it. You can throw them away and buy new ones. So then just with the paint, give it a mix every time you're just about to paint it on, and just swipe it onto the sea sponge. You'll see there's lots of little dots there. So then I just pounce over the entire kit. So you might be able to see, you'll just see there that there's some purpley looking towards the back. A little bit of a different toning. That's where I've actually started. I'm going to see it right there. It's a little bit hard. But so, and then with that, you just pounce over the entire kit, just completely covering it. Now, this will be a slight change to the kit. It won't be very much at all, as you'll see. The light is making it hard to see today. So it's just a very, very slight change. You can see the little purpley dots through there. Okay, so over the entire kit. So when you come to bits like toes and mouths and eyes, just get your brush, swipe it along the edge of your dish, and just pounce it in those little spots ever so lightly, around the ears, around the mouths, and around the chin. If you've got a little bit too much on, then you either pounce it out again with your sea sponge, that'll pick up any excess, or if it's deep in the little creases, I normally just get a finer brush and just pounce that in, and that will just pick up the excess. Okay, so that is the first painting process I'll be doing on Promise. So I'll just show you her other limbs. They've just dried and waiting to be baked. So you can't really see, it's appearing very white, but you can actually see the limbs anyway, and the legs. So you'll see more and more as I go on. But basically, so what I do with that, just let this dry, the paint that I've just put on, and then I'll put it in the oven for 8 minutes and then let cool before I do the next layer. So then I'll do some more videoing there to show you the next layer. Okay, so now step two. What we'll do is get half a tablespoon again of odorless thinners and put it into our little dish. Then I need you to get your flesh 08. And we want two brushes of that. So that'll be basically four sides of the brush. So wipe on one side, and then wipe on the other. Mix it into your eyeless thinners. And then do it again. One brush on one side and a brush on the other side. Okay, so mix that in. Then, so you can see that color just slightly there. It's your normal Flesh 08 color. Then we need yellow. And so just a quarter of a brush of yellow. You can really use any yellow, the Octane or whatever, the other colors as well. But I'll be using this one. And a quarter, we don't want to be overbearing. So it's just like a half of one of these sides. So I normally just sort of do the tip. Just very little bit. Now what this does is give that sort of yellowing effect that you will see under a baby's skin. It's ever so minor. I don't know if you can really see that. I'll try to put it on some paper. Can't even hardly see that. This light is terrible, sorry. But you can tell that there is a different color there. So just mix that out. Then with your typical cosmetic wedge, I just rip the end off. So hold tight, squeeze it in there, squeeze it there, and just pull. So now, instead of the general straight look, we'll have a look that is just a little bit freckly. Wish that would be able to be seen better. So then we get Promise. This is her after the first layer of paint. You should be able to just see those little spots and speckles there. That's of a light fine purple. Okay, so basically get the paint, mix it, wipe it onto your brush, onto your cosmetic wedge, and then once again, pounce it all over. Now pounce it all over the entire kit, then let the kit dry, then pounce another layer over, and then once that second layer dries, we'll put that in the oven for the 8 minutes to bake and seal in place. So see you for the next layer. Hey everyone, so now we're on to step three. So in between step two and step three, I actually opened the nasal passage of this little baby. Now by the way, this baby is named Jesse, and it's a boy which will be born in about a month's time. So I'm not sure if you can see that. I think you can just see that in the light. It's hard for me to see. You can just see the nasal passage is just slightly opened there. So anyway, on step three, what we're going to do is we've got half a tablespoon of our odorless thinners put into our little dish. Let's put this down so you can see a little bit better. Then we've got Flesh 08, like we did in step two. Just put your brush into the odorless thinners to soften the brush. And we want two brushes of Flesh 08, so that's on either side like we did in the other steps. Mix in. And another. I'm wiping over this jar a lot because my paint is all the way to the end. So you can see it's on either side. And then we've got red O2. So I want a quarter brush of that. Quarter, just like so, half of one side. And and then a quarter of burnt umber. So that will make like a apricot peachy kind of pink, pinky brown. So like we did before, with the top of the cosmetics wedge, just grab one end, grab the other, and we want to pull that end off. Actually, I'm better to pull it this way. Like that. Just a nice clean break if possible. And we're going to wipe some of the paint onto our sponge, and then we put it onto the kit, pouncing all over the kit. So you'll do one layer, allow to dry, do another layer, allow that one to dry, and then bake for 8 minutes. So this, once again, like all the other layers, it's just a slight touch. It's not a big notice. You can see, like on the sponge there, that you can see the color there, and you can see that color, if you could see a little bit better, on the kit itself. It's just an ever so gradual touch, each paint layer, just translucent. Okay, so I'll see you back for step four. Okay, so we've just baked layer three, so now we're on to layer four. I don't know if you can see any change. It is hard with my light, I keep telling you that, but I think you can see that between the two, there's a slight change there now, and it will be an ever so slight change, so don't expect anything major at this stage. But from my human eyes, I can see that there's like purple little speckles over there, even sort of looks like tiny capillaries the way it's come out. You can see a dull shading of yellow and then red as well, or like a pinky tone. So it definitely does. I mean, I've seen babies sold and as in full that look like that, so it's going to get a lot more layers than that. Anyway, so now we're going to go on to the veins. So just as before, I use about a tablespoon, so really just a quarter of a tablespoon of your odorless thinners. So this particular level, I don't really have a measurement for the paint, but you'll need some. This is well used, as you can see. This is Filio Blue. So I normally just... It is very dark, so I'll just get like the littlest bit, as you can see, and I'll pull this down so you can see it, and I'll mix it in. It's just kind of like food coloring. You don't really need that much to get the result of what you're looking at. So you can see that blue there. So I'll just put that aside because I'll probably use some more. I just keep mixing it until I get the consistency that I like. As you can see, I've put the wrong lid on here at some stage. So this is Filio Green. So I'll use a little bit more of the green. It's such a nice color. So as we mix this in, you'll see we're getting like a beautiful turquoise color. It's really nice. Now all you have to do is like look at your own veins. Like when I look at my veins, you probably won't be able to see, but my veins, I can see that there's a turquoise sort of color there, and there's also blue colors. So you need to look at your own skin and see what you think you'd like yours to look like. I'll probably do a little bit more blue into that. There, that's probably about the consistency I like. It's sort of like what do they call that? Like a duck egg blue, I think they've called it. So just so you can see a little bit on paper what that will look like. So yeah, you can see that there. It's ever so faint, but it will show out on the skin. So if you, one thing you can do is if you're finding when you're putting it on the baby, it's really not coming as you like it, just add a little touch more of one of those colors or both of those colors to get your results. Now make sure you don't have any blue paint left on your fingers, because a number of times I've had that and I grab the baby and then under its ear or something you'll see this blue spot. So just make sure you keep your hands clean, and if that spot comes onto the baby, just wipe it off straight away with your odorless thinners. So using a thinner brush, I've got a script liner there, you'll see that the end is all frayed, but once I mix it in the paint and twirl it around on the edge, it all comes together anyway. So I won't do all the veins because it will take a long time, but let's just say I was doing one on the forehead there. I do have other videos available on doing veins, so you could always watch them too. But just say do like a little crossroad of a river. You can just see that there. Now you won't see it straight away. So what I do is I just sit here and I go over it and over it and over it again. And each time it gets that little bit darker. Trying to keep it fine. You can see that there on the forehead there. So just keep doing it over and over again. This is not a simple, quick, easy job. You will be doing each vein over and over again. It can take hours, depending on how many veins you're going to put on the baby. So I'll leave it at that for now. Once you get the vein to the consistency you like, you can just get like the top of that wedge we pulled off before, and you can just pounce on it and sort of push out the edges so it all sort of combines into the skin of the baby. If you're wondering where to do veins, normally on a general baby I would do one on the forehead, I'd do one on either temple, maybe do a couple on the ears, just tiny ones. I normally do maybe one here and here, and then on your hands I do one on the top of the hand, because I've got veins all over the top of my hands. So one on the top of the hand, I'll do one on the wrist. Sometimes I'll do even one up here, but they're very fine. And then on the legs, I'll do one in this center little bit of the foot here, one on top of the foot, one on either side of the ankle. Sometimes I'll do one up in the upper leg up here. And sometimes I'll do a little tiny one coming out from underneath the knee here. So you won't need that many. So I'll show you when you do your veins, if you've got a tongue on your baby, you can put a little bit of this vein blue on the tongue, just a ever so little bit, just a touch. Then you'll bake it for 8 minutes and come back for stage 5. And I'll show you my veins then. Okay, so we're up to level 5 or layer 5. This one starts with the mottling layer. So I'll just put it down so you can see the paint. So I've got my dish here and I've got, once again, half a tablespoon of odorless thinners. Put that in there. And with our brush, I've got red O2. I want one brush of red O2. Now remember, that was a swipe on one side and a swipe on the other. Oops, I've done a bit of splash there. So just mix that in. Then ultramarine blue. We just need a quarter of a brush of that. So that's half of one side of the brush. Like that. And mix it in. So this will give you a rich red, reddy maroon colour. More red than maroon. Okay. So then what we want to do is we've got our cosmetic wedges and we need to tweezer out little holes onto this. So basically just get your tweezers, pinch a section and pull. And there you'll see that you've got your first little hole, which will give that mottle effect. So do that all over the sponge. I like to get the corners off. Don't like any hard edges. So there's no necessarily way that you have to do this, just as you like. They can be big, they can be teeny tiny, not all the same. See how we're going there? So there, that looks pretty good. And you can have a better look at that if I paint over it. So with the paint, just go over like that. And you can see that mottling effect there. Okay, so now's to put it on our kit. So we're still with little baby Jessie here, the promise kit. And so far you can see it's just hard to see the actual look, but you can see there's the veining on the forehead there and down the side. So yeah, just have the brush, paint over the sponge and pounce on the entire kit. This will still be a translucent light effect, but you will be able to see it. You can see those little dots down there. So over the entire kit, so all the limbs, over the whole face, head, ears, everywhere. All these subtle layers in the end will all make a difference to get that realistic skin tone. Can be hard working around the face, but just try to go lightly. I'm not sure if you can see that. See on the forehead there, those little dots. Okay, so do that over the entire kit and then bake for 8 minutes and then come back for layer 6. Okay, so now we're on to layer 6, which is another different mottling tone. This one is more of a purpley mottling tone. So I'll just mix the colours for you. Once again, half a tablespoon of your odourless thinners. And then we've got eyelid purple and just one brush of that. Mix it around well. It'll still have that translucent look to it. You can see there. Might add just a tiny little bit more in there. I don't want it to look too translucent. So the same sort of deal as we had before. Have your cosmetics wedge sponge and pull out the little pieces. I've already done that before, save you having to wait. This is little Jessie after the last paint work. So you can see the little specks of red over it, the little mottling tone. It's barely there, but from my angle you can tell. And you can also tell by looking at the base. If you look at the base there, you can definitely see that there's a difference between up and there. So we are getting some 3D dimensions to that, even though it might be a little bit hard for you guys to see from there. So with the purple, once again, brush it over your cosmetic wedge and just pounce it over the entire kit. You can see those little speckles spots there. As I've mentioned before, it's a translucent layer. You will be able to see it to the naked eye. A little bit hard via video because of the glaring light coming through the window here. Over the face, mouth, everything. Just pouncing it on. It'll make also little effects, which you'll notice later, that look like little capillaries and that. So you can see the little mottled tone there. There's definitely, you can see it on the side there a lot with the light shining on it. Okay, so with that, do that layer over the entire kit, and then we'll come back. Actually, I should just quickly do that. The little legs. So this is a double mottle layer. So like I said before, over the entire kit. Sorry, this is taking a few minutes, but there is another layer at the end, which I'll need to show you how to mix. This is before it's heat set, so don't go anywhere. Maybe if you're working on your own kit at the moment, you can just leave me running and then pause it just before I start on the next layer. Ever so teeny tiny, these hands and feet, I promise. As I've mentioned before, this is a replica portrait baby. This baby will be actually turning one in a few weeks. So I will be reborning this baby on his birthday, 1 year after he was born, as a preemie baby this size. So they'll have him available to be seen, this kit, available to be seen at his party, so everyone can then get an idea of what he actually was like 1 year ago. Okay, so I'll bring you down again here, back to our paint. We're going to do another mottling layer, but this time we're going to add some purple 06. That's a light lavender lilac color. So a brush, so one on either side. This just gives it a little bit of dimension. Mix it in there, so it now should become kind of like a plummy violet color. So with that layer we just did, we don't need to bake that yet because we're going to put this layer on. So you would be letting your layers dry. So yeah, you can see on the top of its head there that there's a purpley speckled look. You can even notice some reds and some yellows in the undertones. So now I'll put this layer on. it's fairly dry, but you make sure you let it dry properly. And just pounce over the entire kit again. This should still be a fairly translucent color. If it's not very translucent, you might want to just add a little bit more odorless thinners. Sometimes I like it to be a little bit more visual at this stage. I am with this baby because obviously it's a preemie baby, and this baby I will be making to look closer to a preemie baby, so it's going to have that like reddish tone that you'll see a preemie baby's skin has. So I'm trying to get to that level. So you can definitely notice the mottling on this layer, especially look at the side of the head there. See? Okay. So once again, if you look at that compared to the bottom of the head there, you can see that there's a definite change going on there. So pounce that over your entire kit, and then you'll bake it for the 8 minutes, and then we'll start on layer 7. We're getting there. Hey everyone, so today we're back for step 7. Well, you're still here, but anyway, we're up to step 7. So for step 7, we're going to do a kind of a flesh tone sort of layer on this baby. So I'll just put you down again, look at the paints. So we're going to use half a tablespoon of your odorless thinners into your little dish. So half a tablespoon. Okay, then with our brush, we're going to, I need to moisten that again. So we're going to use one brush of Flesh 08. Okay, mix that into your odorless thinners. Then we've got, this is Flesh 07. See the size comparison of those jars. Okay, so one brush of Flesh 07. Here, coming out there. Mix that in. Okay, then we want a quarter of yellow octane or ochre or something. Anyway, if you don't have this, you can just use normal yellow. It is okay. Just got a quarter of that. This just gives like a little yellow undertone to it. If you are using the brighter yellow, of course, just use maybe just the tip of your brush, not much at all, because as you can see, that looks like a flesh tone. If you add too much yellow, it might look too yellowy. Okay, so back to babes. So here is how Jessie's looking now. You can see all the little details when you look up at the top there. Skin's really taking effect. Okay, so with that one, I want you to get your sea sponge, if you've got your sea sponge. If you don't have a sea sponge, I suggest, you know, just your usual kitchen sponge. Obviously a clean one, a brand new one. But I've used that before, and it works just as well. And you know, you can cut off like little pieces of your sponge, and you can throw it away. But this is my sea sponge. I think I showed you earlier in the piece. I use one side for like a purpley tone, one of the first tones, and then the other side like a flesh. But I've used this for so long, so they really last a long time. They are expensive. One of these I send through Aussie Reborn Supplies, posted for $5.50. That's Australian. But like I said, this has lasted me ages, so don't be afraid to spend the money on a sea sponge. Okay, so what we're going to do is just put your paint on your sea sponge, and we want to cover the whole entire kit. Pouncing just over like that, your whole kit. You can see the colour there. Once again, this is just, as they all are, very minor translucent look. There's a lot to go. So I pounce over the entire kit. If I'm getting in spaces like ears, I just use the brush. Just make sure there's not too much paint on. Just pounce in there, the little back of the neck there. Pounce in the ears, around the eyes, and the nose and the mouth, and under the neck. That just gets in all the little nooks and crannies. Okay, it's looking good. Again, I'm still working in that light that has been bothering me every time I work with this for you, but I'll show you, you should be able to see, that there's definitely a colour difference in the bottom of the baby neck to the top. You can see that there's a different, definite paint colour difference. Okay, now I'm not sure if I remember to tell you in the last step, but the last bit of paint from the last step, the little purple part we had left, we're going to use that now in this layer 7. So if you have thrown it away like I have, I'll just quickly make a quick batch up again. If you've got it there, keep it. You only need a little bit. So I'm just going to get like a quarter. Yeah, actually that's more than a quarter, but yeah, a quarter of a tablespoon of your odorless thinners. Then it was your purple. Eyelid purple. So it was a brush of that. Obviously this is a small portion, so maybe just one side of the brush. You should be able to tell what you need by looking at the paint to what color it is. Then there was some of the purple O2. So just add like a little bit, like a half a tablespoon there, a brush. Okay, so there's my purple made up. So what you do is once this one dries, all your pieces of this kit, this purple, I want you just with a brush. I'll demonstrate it on one of my little toes. So once this is dry from your flesh layer, just like I said, just get the brush and just sort of tap over the toes. And anywhere you think that it would be a little bit slightly purple. So I normally do just a bit over the toes, maybe a tiny bit on the ankles, a little tiny bit behind the knees. On the hands, I would go over the fingertips, like the top of the fingertips, just a little bit, just like it's on the knuckles. Maybe a little bit on the elbow. And then on the face, I will do a little bit over the eyelids, inside the ears, inside the nose a little bit if you've opened the nose. If you haven't opened the nose yet, definitely inside the nose, just a little tap. You might want to get a smaller brush for that. And then a little bit like a first layer on the lips, just a touch. Okay, so once you've done all that, and remember, it's this purple layer is not You're hardly going to see it. It's just a touch. In the end, you do notice that there's a different tone to the toes and that. So we don't want that to actually wipe off. But if you get a cosmetic wedge, if you think you've overdone it a bit, just lightly tap on it, a dry cosmetic wedge. I'm using the ends that I pull off. So just you'll just tap on it just to soak up any excess paint there and gives it a small blend in. So once you've done your flesh layer that we've just made, and then put your purple highlights to the anywhere you think needs a little purple highlight, then you'll need to bake for the 8 minutes and come back for layer 8. Okay, see you in a minute. Hey everyone, I hope you're going okay with your painting process. If you have any questions along the way, please post a message below on the YouTube's messages and I can get back to you. Or you can contact me directly. If you have Facebook, you can go to Miracle Babies Newborn Nursery, and or you can also find me at Aussie Reborn Supplies on Facebook. And I also have an email address, live.com.au. I'll probably put that in the little comments below so you will be able to see it. But any questions at all about any process, you know, just post me a little message and I will be able to at least help you with that. That's what I'm here for. Okay, so we're on to layer 8, and this is just a little tiny layer. We still have a lot to go. So if you're feeling like your baby hasn't got much tone or color in, I mean, you should have definite different tones in by now. But if you feel like you haven't, there is a lot more to go. So you can see on Jesse, he is definitely getting different tones. So this one, as you can see, or as you know, is a Preemie baby, and it will be getting those red tones that a Preemie baby does get, but that'll come along the way. But now we're just doing a little feature of the nails and the lips and stuff. So what I need you to have now is your glazing gel. Pretty important. If you don't have glazing gel, I guess you could use like a thinning medium or something, because this process is kind of a bit of a thicker type of paint. So just get my little sponge here. Just want a little tip. I'll just get a little tip. So the glazing gel, I myself don't have much left, but I'll just put this down so you can see. So I need like about a pea size amount. I'm going to get a little bit less than a pea size amount, probably that. So it's probably about a small size pea, a small pea. And you just put it straight into your dish. You just see it just there. So there we go. Then we need some red O2, and I just want a brush of that. So remember, the brush was, I know I've got a smaller lip brush here, so definitely use a smaller brush, but just a swipe on either side is a brush. This will be good because you'll be able to see it better. So mix it in with your glazing gel. The glazing gel's thick, so it sort of stays put. Okay. Then we've got your ultramarine blue. And for that, I only need like a quarter. So I'll just get some of that red color off there. So just that smaller end of one side and mix it in. So if you can see that now, that's taking on a maroony red kind of shade. And you can see it's thick. Okay, so that's what kind of color we want to get from that. You can see. Okay, So these are teeny tiny nails, so I need a teeny tiny brush. I might even get smaller than this. Where's my little brush? This one might do it. Just get like this type of, it's a thicker script liner. So you just get a little bit on your brush, and what we just want to do is paint each of the nails. I might show it a bit better with the toenails. Get you in a bit close. Like this. And I just paint it on ever so fine. I'm hoping you can see the colour in that thumb or big toe. I'll show you the other ones. This is like an ever so light touch. I mean, look at your own nails. You'll see your own nail is a, you know, there's a little bit of a pink tone. It's different than your skin, obviously. So that's all we're trying to do here. Just give it that edge of a different color, so it's standing out against the nails. If it's too dark, I mean, we don't want that to be like a big red nail. We just want it to be a touch. So you can just see those nails have a touch. Now, if I was to put a lot of paint on that, let me just do that. That looks not right. It stands out. It's not natural at all. We just want that pink tone to it. So if you do get dark, just get your little sponge and just pounce on there. Sometimes I even just get my finger and just pounce my finger on there. We've got a lot to go with the nails. I mean, there's still a nail tip to go towards the end. So I'm hoping you can just see. It's just a light tip tone. Okay, so you'll do that on all of the toenails and all of the fingernails. You'll also do it on baby's lips. So I'll just hopefully see that fine. Now we don't want to make it like too dark or anything, but to get it on, oh wait, just we want to paint it on so you can see, and then you can pounce the color out. This is not going to be his final lip color. This is going to be just that touch so we can see his lips there. Don't feel obliged to stay to that paintbrush you're using either. If it's not working for you, put it aside and get one that is. I'll also come in and use this bigger brush as well. You can just pounce onto it too. It doesn't have to be brushed on. And make sure you get in those corner creases. Obviously that's too much, but that's all right. We're here, we're going to pounce it out. We're going to give it that, make sure you don't pounce it out like, because we don't want it to go onto the cheeks such. This is the glazing gel. Once again, you can use your finger, even your nails, to get in there and limit the color to the edges. I also sometimes like squeeze the kit, which will open that mouth a little bit more to allow me to get into those edges, the center part. And also we're going to put a little bit in the nostrils as well. These nostrils definitely weren't showing out, so I need to darken them a little bit. And obviously I don't want my nostrils to appear like they're bloody or anything, so I'll get a dry brush and I'll pounce in there. That's not the brush I want to use. Let's see if this one works. So just pouncing a brush in there will pick up some of the colour, so it's not so full on. You can also get earbuds, and you can just spin them at the edge of the nose there. Got some red in my nail there, I just noticed. Okay. So that's sort of bringing him to life a bit. As you can see, now you can tell his nasal passage is open. Once again, it can be your own decision if you want to put any of that paint elsewhere. Sometimes I would recommend a little dab inside the ears. I'll just show you that's an ear without any paint in. And then if I just dab in there, ever so lightly, you can now see that's given that a bit more depth. So you don't want to notice much, just so it now stands out. And we can even make those eyes a little bit standy outy too by just doing a little line across the eye. Nothing major. But you can see now that he's standing out that little bit better. And we'll just get our little earbud and wipe over that. And that's looking good. So all your fingernails, all your toenails, your lips inside the nasal passage. You can put a tiny bit in the ears and a little bit on the eye line. That's not that important. It's up to you if you want to do that. It's not, this isn't the creases process or things like, or even the blushing process, that's going to come next. But this can just give that little touch as well. Okay, so now I need you to go and bake it for your 8 to 10 minutes and then come back here for layer 9. Okay, thanks. Okay, hey everyone, level 9, layer 9. Hopefully I'm getting those layers right as I'm going. So today we're doing the blushing details of your baby. So that'll be like your elbows, knees, under your feet, palms of hands, a bit of lips and around the cheeks. So to do that, what we need, I'll put you down so you can see. We've got our odorless thinners. Again, half a tablespoon into the little dish. We're going again with red O2. So for red O2, we want a brush. So if you remember that again, that's one on either side. Swipe on either side. Okay, mix that in. Okay, then we need some ultramarine blue, pretty much the same colours, well it is the same colours that we just did on the last layer, but this is a little bit more of a translucent layer. The other one was translucent but in a different way. Okay, so this one, again, we're going with a quarter of a brush, something like that. Mix it in. So just like the other colour, you'll get a maroney red, blood red sort of shade. Oops, I keep spelling that. So once again, don't be afraid of the colors. This comes out as a translucent color and can be pounced out if you've got too much color there. So here's Jessie after yesterday's paint work. Okay, so you'll just need a cosmetic wedge and you can use this brush, but I'll just see if I've got my other brush here first. Yep, a lot of you artists will have a Maxine's mop. So that's what that looks like. That's really good. Because of the different layers of bristles on that, it just will work better than a straight edge brush. Okay, so I'm going to start with the feet. Okay, so just mix your brush around in the paint. Wipe off the edge to let go of some of that thinness. And then I'm just going to pounce on the sole of the foot. Let's see if I can't get a better look at this. Okay, so I'm going to pounce all around the toes, around the top, but I'm going to leave that arch part clear. So just like that, pouncing with your brush. See the colour going on that now? As you can see, that's going on very translucent compared to the colour that you can see in the actual pan. It's very translucent. So I believe with these colours, less is more. So obviously it doesn't matter if it's not much here and you feel like it needs more, you can come back and give it some more. Okay, I'll also go on the knees, the ankles on either side, and across the top of the toes. So I'd always like to let that sit for a moment and come back with my sponge and sponge it out afterwards, because the best thing about this is you can wipe it off if you don't like it. So I'll do a hand now, an arm. So once again, over the palm of the hand, over the entire palm, over the fingers. Just if you get a little bit of paint in between the fingers, probably best to pounce it out, keep it going. You can see there that the hand obviously is like a pinky red color compared to that, which is still a skin color. So the elbows with this one as well, and across the top of the fingers, and even across the top of the knuckles just here. This is where we really want to give that color change to the skin. And then with the face, the head, some more. Obviously it takes a little bit more. So I'll go inside the ears some more, around the tops of the ears. Just like that. I'll go on the eyes, just on the eyelid, just across here. If you've got a bigger baby, it's easy to go a little bit into the nose. It's a little bit hard with this, but I'll just ever so gently go in there. And then across the cheek. So I tend to go like a tick, down and up, down and up. Just like we do on our own makeup. Gives that blush, like that cheekbone look. See that there? And then across the nose, or just on the tip of the nose, center of the forehead, on each temple, and on the chin. So you can see it on the temple there, the center of the head, on the eyes, on the nose, just a little bit in the nose, cheeks, your chin, your ears, and just a touch on the lips as well. Not much, we're not doing the lips yet, we're just doing them gradually. Okay, so I'll just show you that foot again. And then getting on the knee and the top of the foot. And the ankles. And the hand. Sorry, I'm just trying to get it so you can really see it. Elbow and on the tips of the hands there. So if it's too much, now it's time to pounce it out. If you want some more, add some more. It would have had a little bit of a dry. Don't forget too, if you want to know exactly where to do your special pinpoints, you can go onto Google and just research pictures of baby hands, babies' faces, get some close-up looks and find yourself where you find those colors should really be prominent. No two babies the same, so it's not right or wrong. You just want to get the color tone right. The best thing I think I like about these Maxine mops is when you get to the edges of the foot or the leg, you can really pounce in there and it gives a really speckled sort of look. Obviously, when I put my photo in between as I have been, you'll see that this colour a little bit better. A bit more on the ankles, across the toes, and the knee again. Can see that the knee is darker there, the toes. Look at it compared to the one I haven't done. You can see that there's a difference there, can't you? I know the light's not perfect, but you can certainly get the idea there. That's a really good picture. So you can see in the arch of the foot there that I don't have any, but the rest of the foot I do. In this foot you can see that there's nothing on it. So completely different. And then with the hand, I'll show you that again. Just want to add a little bit more to the palm. And the elbow. Cross the fingers. So you can see there again, two different looks. You can see the palm, definitely this one here definitely has some colouring to it when the other one doesn't. The fingers, they're starting to be more prominent and stand out. And then you've got the elbow there. Show a little bit better. Right, and then the face, you can see just by that like pinpoint in the middle, you can see it sort of standing out. So a little bit more over the eyes, basically go over all your points again. Don't be afraid too much, because we'll pounce this out with the brush, not with the sponge. And then, you know, once it's all baked and everything, there's other layers that are going to go over the top, which will blend them a little bit more. So going back to the foot, it looks quite good. So I just pounce out that with the cosmetic wedge to get any excess paint off that I don't like. After all, we don't want it to look like there's a big red spot on its ankle or things like that. We want to make it look like it's blending into where there's no colour. So if you can see the knee there, you can see that it's nice and pink. Looks like it's blending into the colour without being just a big red knee. Okay, so do that. And then don't throw away your blushing mix, because on layer 10 we're going to just be adding a color to it and putting some color just across here. So keep that mix, it'll be up next. Okay, so how did you go on layer 9? We're on layer 10 now. So this is little Jesse with his blushing. You can just see a little bit on his cheek there and his eyes. It's better actually to see in the naked eye, but you will see that in the pictures that I put in between. So now, like I said before, I hope you've still got the remainder of your last paint. So that was for the blushing detail. So just whatever you've got left, now what we're going to add to that is some burnt umber. So I want to add a quarter of a brush of the burnt umber. Mix that in. And I want to add a quarter of yellow. So what you should get is like a burnt sort of orangey brown sort of kind of look. You can see the little tinges of yellow in it. Whoops. So this layer is pretty simple. All you need is to just probably go back to your Maxine mop again if you've got one. If not, just use the brush you've got. Mix that around, pounce out the end of your brush, and then I just want you to pounce a little line across the top of the upper cheek, just up here, and then a little bit on the nose. So just pounce it in there and on the nose. Once again, as in with all of the stages, it's just a touch. You can see that there. So what I do there is just let it dry a little bit. But I won't do it for the video, as you'll be waiting all day. So just let that, you would just let it dry a bit. Once it's dried, just get your cosmetic wedge, just the one you were using for the blushing to blend it in, and just blend this in. So just a light pounce, ever so light. You can add some more to it. Run down the face. know, once again, remember, there's going to be skin tones over this as well, so it'll all blend in. If you're thinking at the moment, oh my god, looks like a clown or something like that, don't. It'll blend in. Of course, you don't want it to really show out. We're not trying to give the baby a sunburnt look or anything. We're just trying to, like, feature, like, that top of that cheek there and the nose. So just ever so light. And there you go. You can just see that now is, like, a bit more standout in. Okay? So go and just bake your head for the 8 to 10 minutes and then come back for layer 11. We're getting there.
Okay.
So now we're up to layer 11. So what you will need is another half a tablespoon of your odorless thinners. Get the burnt umber. We need a brush of that. Mix it in there. Then we've got the red O2. A quarter. You can see that's getting a reddy brown tone there. And then the yellow ochre. I think that's how you say it. O-C-H-R-E. And a quarter of that. Now, even though you can hardly see that yellow, you still will get those highlights in the skin. Okay, so that's great. So with this layer, it's going to go over the entire kit. And it's going to be brushed over. So once your paint is all mixed well, Jesse, remember, he's going really well. Just paint over with your brush directly. So you can see I'm directly doing that. So over the entire kit. This is basically, you can use it on your newborn size, but sometimes when I'm doing a newborn size, so if you are, sometimes I will skip this layer because it does bring out a really red, or not a really red, but a redder tone. I have done them in the newborns before and it does look really good. But it especially looks good on the preemies, because, as you know, a really early born preemie will have that really red skin and like underdeveloped, and that's what we're trying to get here. But it doesn't necessarily look underdeveloped if you're doing it on a newborn. Sometimes you might just want to add in another flesh tone or something. So it's looking really good. But definitely on this baby, because it is a preemie, I want to get that underdeveloped skin tone. Ever so much that I might do another layer if this doesn't go all to plan. So you can either use, this is a bottle gourd sponge. You might have seen them. They're really good. They're reusable. They rinse out. Or you can just use your general sponge. I'll use the bottle gourd. And I'm just going to pounce that in, just so we don't have any brush edges or marks in there. Just the tiniest touch. I don't want to suck up too much paint. And you should also get a brush, like your Maxine mop. And as you can see, you might be able to see in that eye there, there looks like there's too much paint gone in. So just pounce in there to get any excess paint around the nose, in the nostrils, the mouth, underneath the chin, and in the ears and around. That will just do just like what that sponge just did. So as you can see, compared to say the legs, there's a new tone there again. So let that dry and bake for your 8 to 10 minutes. If you think you'd like to get a bit more of a red tone on this baby, on your own preemie baby, you can do another layer of red after you bake it, which I think I will be doing because I personally know this baby had a very red tone to it. Okay, so next is layer 12. Layer 12. Okay, so with layer 11, I did speak about doing a few layers if you thought that you needed to. I personally did 3 layers with Jessie. Now, Jessie is going to be a replica of an actual preemie baby, and his firstborn pictures were the baby was very, very red with that very translucent skin tone. So she didn't want it quite that red, but she wants it sort of an in-between, a natural skin tone and that red. So I'd layered on 3 layers. As you can see, his skin is close to mine, but is a little bit more pinkish reddish tinge. So I've still got more to do. As you know, we're doing more. He will get a little bit more redder, but this one compared to another one I'm working on at the same time, you can see it's more pinkish, more reddish. I didn't do lots of layers on her because it's not to be that preemie look. It's just going to have a natural skin tone. So that's what we're up to with Jessie. So now we're on to layer 11, layer 12, like I said. So what we're going to do, I'll just show you the legs while I'm there so you can see. It's a really nice color and it's definitely different to mine. Okay, so with the layer 12, again, we are using 1/2 tablespoon of the odorless thinners, ultramarine blue, very popular color, isn't it? 1/2 brush. So I'll just wet my brush with the odorless thinners. 1/2 brush is one side, just like that, not on the other side. Mix around. And then it's best to use crimson red, but if you don't have crimson red, I just use the red O2. Crimson red is just a little bit more of a maroney red than this one. So 1/4 brush of that one. So you'll see it's just a maroony, purpley sort of looking red, probably more of a maroon than that. Now this, with this one, this is just like a bit of a feature colour. So we're going to use this colour on all of the things that have look like they have the translucent skin on a baby. So you would use it on the wrists, the palms, the soles of the feet, knees, elbows, a little on the lips, a little on either side of the nose, you put a little bit in the ears. So it's just basically a feature. So let's say with the feet, I've already, as you know, done the blush on the foot, but this little arch part of a baby's foot is very translucent. So I just put a little dab there and I'm going to let it dry. This is ever so slight, this paint. Sometimes I don't even do it on the babies, but with this preemie, I want him to look definitely like stand out in those little sections. And it will be viewable. So just put the paint wherever you think in those spots, let it dry, and then with a cosmetic wedge, just pounce it out just to make sure any excess paint is out. Now with this layer of paint, with the paint when it's finished, don't let it go. It's going to also be used in layer 13. Layer 13 is another big full layer, as is 14. And then we're going to be slowing down to doing the eyebrows, the nail tips, the creases. So we're almost there. So stay with me. So yep, just once again, with this color, just in those feature spots. I'm going to put it in the ears, side of the nose, a little on the lips. You can even put it on the top of the eyelids, especially with a baby of a preemie size. They do have that translucent, so thin skin. I know this would have thin skin all over its body, but these are just to accentuate those little features. Palms of hand, elbows and knees. Okay, so don't forget to hold that paint and be ready to use it in a moment.
Okay, 13.
So this is number 13. So after you have baked that last paint work that you did, which was just the features, we're going to add a little bit more to the paint we were using before. So just a little bit more odorless thinners, not much. And then another quarter of the crimson red. As you can see it there. Mix that all around. I'll try to get that paint on there for you. So there's about the color that it is going to be. So now what we want to do is, earlier you had a mottling sponge. You may still have that, you may have thrown it away. If you have thrown it away, just make up another one. So get your normal sponge, get the tweezers and pick it out like we did earlier. And this layer is going to go across the whole entire kit. You may be thinking, oh my god, more red, but this is a preemie baby we're working on, as I've said before. And if you choose not to use this layer, that's okay. It's your baby, and how you think it's going to be done is totally up to you. The next layer after this will be a fleshy tone color. So anyway, just pop it on like you did earlier and then pounce it over the entire kit. Remembering this color is still a translucent color. So although we saw it on the paper, it will still look that translucent look. You'll be able to see the little speckles there it's starting to produce. So this layer over the entire kit, bake in your oven for the 8 to 10 minutes and then get ready for layer 14, which will be the flesh tone. It's more of a blending layer, and after that, that'll be the last major layer. Then you'll have creases, eyebrows, finish off the lips and the nail tips. Okay. Okay, time for layer 14. We're doing really well and we're on the blending layer now. So from there, like I said, they'll be just small points. So this is how little Jesse's looking now. You can see that he definitely has like a red tone compared to my normal white skin tone, but it's not overbearing at all. You can see that, all the different features of his head there. Looks looking good, as are his arms. Okay, so let's just work this one out. We'll show you how to mix this layer. So once again, as usual, we've got our half a tablespoon of odorless thinners. Now just to let you know, while I'm working on this, I'm actually working on another one. So this paint is normally being going to another baby as well. So that half a tablespoon will do for the two babies. The other baby is about an 18 inch baby. I showed you it in one of the clips before. So make your paint last. If you need to add a little bit more thinners to it, a tiny bit more paint for the second baby, that's great, but it's going to save you a lot of waste. It's really good. I always work on at least two albums. Okay, so the flesh tone I'm using in this one is 06. You can use anything. If you want to tone that red tone down, you could go for an 08. Or if you're still wanting to get it darker, you could even go for an 05. But I'm doing the 06. And I need 1.5 brushes. So the one brush, remember from earlier, is on either side. Now you might see me going over this paint a little bit more because this 6 one is getting a little bit old. So sometimes I need to rub it again. But it looks like it's doing okay at the moment. So that was one brush, so I now need another half. That's good. Hope everyone's babies are turning out nicely. I would love to see some pictures after you've all done. It'd be really great to be able to share them. Maybe in a video. Bit of a shout out for you. Okay, so then we're going, yes, for red again. This one is the red 05. So it's the brighter of the reds. So I want a quarter of that. Don't be a generous quarter. Do a little quarter. So I'm not going to rub too much. This should give your paint just a touch of red. It'll almost look like the edges in your pot are red. If you think you need a little bit more, like I think I need a bit more, just grab another little bit. It's going to be one of those scents, as a subtle scent. Then we've got the raw sienna. That's like the yellow mustardy kind of one. We're going for a quarter of that one as well. Don't mind being a little bit more generous with that. See that there? Okay. Great. So you can see that just looks like a coffee, really. I can slightly see a yellow and a red sort of edging in there. Okay, so this again goes over your entire kit. So I'm going to get my cosmetic wedge and I'm going to pull off the end so it gives a bit of a texture there. As you remember from earlier, just textured end. And then paint some of my paint on the edge and pounce over the entire kit. Simple as that. Now this is a blending layer, so this will just blend it all together and make those colors look like they are undertones. I'll just see if I can show you the color so you can see that is a skin tone. Well, a dark skin tone, but it will go over and blend it all. So go ahead and pounce over your entire kit and then let to dry, and then bake in your oven for the 8 to 10 minutes. If you feel like it's not quite blended enough before you bake it, you can put another layer over the top of it, but it shouldn't be a problem, as you saw the color that it come out with. Most layers, as you know, you can't really tell until they've been baked and you're looking at it after it's all dry. Okay, so do that layer and then we will come back and do the creases and fix our lips up and eyebrows. So we're nearly done. I'm going to finish painting this baby today. Okay, so on to layer 15. We've just done the blending layer. So hoping your baby's turning out well. This is Jesse after my blending layer. So as you can see, his skin tones look nice and even, and all the features The 3D toned features are coming out nicely and are definitely blended in. So I'm really happy with that. So now we're doing the creases layer. Now with the creases layer, I have a special paint that I have always used and I absolutely adore. So I'm going to stick to that. It's a Seacrest brand, Authentic Reborn. Now this comes in four different like shades, specialized shades. You can get Vintage Blossom, Sweetheart Rose, Peaches and Cream, and Strawberry. My favorite being the Peaches and Cream, and this one is the Creases and Wrinkles. Each of those color shades come in a set. So you get the Creases and Wrinkles, the Lips, and the Blush, three pots in the set. Now I sell them at Aussie Reborn Supplies, so that's www.aussiereborn.com.au. I also sell them on eBay, but I'm in Australia, so if anyone is in Australia, I will send overseas, but I think you can get it in your own area anyway. So that's the one I'll be using. Now with this, it's so perfect because there's no mixing needed. It already comes with a thinning medium mixed into it, so all I need to do is get my brush over it and paint directly on. But for you, if you want to, you have to make your own paints. So some of you might already have a creases color, you can use that. Or if you want to make it up from scratch, you'll need a pea size amount of thinning medium. Put that into your little bowl. Then the red 05, a quarter of a brush. Now that will be using a small brush, something similar to, I know this is a bit furry, but about, so a quarter of a brush of that, a quarter of flesh 07, and then a quarter of burnt umber. Okay, so then just mix them around and then you'll have that ready to go. And because it's a thinning medium, it'll be a lot like this one. So I'll just show you that closer. You can see that it's shiny, it's got like a bit of a wet tone to it. So what I will do, and what you will do the same with yours, is I just run my brush over it, so it's on there, and then go through all of the creases. So over the eye, and see I've just done over there, and do over this eye. Now the beauty about this paint is it, because it's already a pre-mix, it's already going to come out in that translucent look. So they basically say that you can just put it on and you can bake it. I personally like to still have, just got the end of my cosmetic wedge from before, I still like to have that cosmetic wedge that once that has dried, I might pounce over, and any sharp edges, I'm going to fan them out. So do that over the whole kit on any creases. So like if you've got an eye crease like little Jessie has here, you know, just get in there and paint the line. So you can already see that that has the translucent look. But yes, I don't like any of the sharp edges. So do that on any where you see a crease. So lines, sides of nose, under the chin, in the ears. Obviously on the hands and feet, you'll do every line that you see. Under the toes, on the base of the foot there, behind the knees, behind the foot here, the ankle. And you can also do your own features if you like. Like one feature a lot of kits don't have, this one has it, but you know how with a baby's hands and feet you get those little dimples in the spots there? If your kit doesn't have that, you can already always put your own little dimples in there and just pounce it out lightly. So once you have done all of the creases, then it's time to bake for the 8 to 10 minutes. And then come back here and we'll start the next layer, which I believe is going to be the eyebrows and lips. Okay, so just get that done and we'll see you soon. Okay, so 16, let's start on the lips. Now with these next three layers, first we're going to do lips, then we're going to do your nail tips, and then we're going to do your eyebrows. So you can do each level and you can bake as you do it, or you can do the three levels and then bake all together, which is what I'm going to do. But first we'll do the lips. So basically you'll need some thinning medium like you might have used with your creases, and we just need a pea size amount of that. I've got like a small lip type brush, so grab out like a small pea size amount, put in your little dish. Then we need the red O2, we need a quarter of that, so a quarter of your small brush, only small. Got your thinning medium in there, won't be able to see it really well, but just mix that in with your thinning medium. Then Mars Black. Yes, black. A quarter of a brush of that. And mix that around. That will give you that rich plum maroon type colour. It's not terrible. And as you can see in the white marks, it's only very fine. Okay, so we can put those colours away. We're so close to the end. Okay, so I have the little bubs. And obviously, because he is so tiny, I'm not even sure if this brush is going to work. But what we're going to do is paint your lip shape. So any shape you want it to be. Normally you do like the M shape at the top, and then a thin line, or it could be thicker. Depends on the baby you're doing, I guess. So I'll just start this. I might have to use a finer brush. This again, because of the thinning medium, will still be subtle, even though we're using some really bold colours there. As you know, as we've been going, we've been adding a little bit of shading to the lips here and there. So that's already taken on most of the base coat. This is just to highlight. So just keep going until you're happy with the way that is, and then just let it set for a bit. So I'm going to fiddle with that a bit, and then we'll go on to 17 for the nails. Okay, so number 17. I hope I'm getting all these numbers right. I'm just letting his lips dry there. So they're nice. Because his little baby has very dark hair, so everything's going to be dark there. So we're going to do the nail tips. So once again, I've got my nail colour, it's like a off white yellow. I've got it pre-mixed. You can buy a pre-mix. This is my handmade pre-mix, but you can buy a pre-mix which is called Nail Tip. To make it yourself, you could get the thinning medium, a pea size amount of thinning medium, and then a brush of Flesh 07. And just a dash of yellow, which will give it that off-white look. I personally, at that stage when I made this, used just titanium white and added a little yellow. So this is like a lemony cream tinge. So I already mixed that in a old nail tip container. And what I just do is I get my odorless thinner, just dip my brush in odorless thinner, and then wave it in here to sort of soften it up a little bit, like that. Once it's soft, it'll come on my brush nice. And then just basically do it as you would a little nail. So you can see the nail clearly there. So I'll just do a strip along the tip. just very slightly, as you can see there. So I'll do a few more, hoping you can see what I'm doing here. I might stand up. So just a little strip along the end. Sometimes these brushes tend to fray and then they don't work as well. So hoping that you could see that. Again, just a little tip. So go and do your nail tip on all your toenails and all your fingernails and either bake that and come back for the eyebrows, or just let that sit aside, pick up bub, so we can do the eyebrows. So that will be number 18. Okay, so now we're going to work on the eyebrows. So I've just got some brow brown, which I've just mixed on the side there with some odorless thinners just to thin it out a bit. I'm going to try to get this screen a little bit closer to me here so you can see how I do it. It's just get a script liner and literally, or just swiping it on. Now this baby, the lady has actually said that his eyebrows were dark, but literally looked like they were painted on. So that works good for me, because I'm painting them on. Okay, so just keep going. Very fine lines. Remembering the benefit, or the best part about this, is if I don't like the way it's going on, I can just wipe it off. So I'll just do it like that so you can see. And then when I do the other side, it gets confusing. You're finding you're going like this trying to get it right, but I normally sort of sit it in front of me and I normally work backwards. Hoping you can see that all right. There's no right or wrong way really to do eyebrows. I think it's just something that some people are good at and other people aren't. It takes practice and patience and a steady hand. See, so that's just very fine, but you can keep going over that. What I'm going to do is this baby, I'll have to show you a picture at the end, but he had the eyebrows, but then his hair sort of came down into the area where his forehead were and almost looked like his eyebrows went into his hair. So I'm going to do a few strips of paint along there to make it look like those fine hairs are there, and then I'll be rooting the rest. So that's him now. You'll see a picture in a minute, which will be of him with the paintwork done here. And then I'll do some more videoing on his hair. So get your hair ready. Okay, so just quickly before I go to bake him, you might be able to see those fine lines I've put up above his eyebrow over to the side here. And then around to this side. The baby, like I said, himself had all those little fine lines. So now I'm going to go into the hair process. So I hope you have your hair and needle and rooting tool ready for the next part. Okay, so we're up to the hair rooting. Woo! Not far to go now, especially if you're working on a preemie baby. It'll be really quick. So anyway, hopefully you can see the fine hairs I just painted up on his forehead there, just very fine. Now that was because his mum told me that when he was born, he almost looked like he had painted hair. It was black and it was thin and it just looked like it was painted on. And you'll see in the end, I will post a picture of him, and you'll see it does really look painted on. So I thought those fine hairs at the front there that I would paint on, and then the rest will be rooted. So I have got some Slumberland black mohair here. Now I can't say enough how you really should be using a quality mohair. I use Slumberland, I often use Delta Dawn, and there are other very great mohair types as well. There's even newborn barn, I think it is. I'll post some links anyway to all of them. They're all fantastic hair. I think this one here I'm working on is using some hair from Newborn Barn. I think it's Newborn Barn. Anyway, I'll let you know. But it just is perfect. It sits perfectly. There's not much breakage or fall away. You'll find if you're using a cheap mohair, you'll have so many little hairs all over you because it's like breaking. It's like split ends. It's just so yucky. This might be expensive, but I won't use all of this for his hair. I'll hardly use any, so I can then use it for other babies, and it's just good to use. So anyway, I've got my rooting tool, as everyone probably has seen before. Mine has been used for probably about 10 years now and is still in great condition except for a little bit dirty, but that's okay. So the needle I'm using today, I've got a 40 gauge one barb in there. But I would suggest maybe even doing a 40 gauge three barb crown needle for the Preemie. It's just a bit thinner, but I've just got this one in and I'm going to see how it goes. Shears are always good. If you don't have shears, that are just perfect for reborning. I'd highly recommend them. I do sell them at Aussie Reborn Supplies, but they're just so easy to use. I mean, if I'm having to cut eyelashes, I can get in there nice and easy without this big bulky pair of scissors there, and they're just so precise and so perfect. They work great. So anyway, I'll get my mohair out. I'm not going to video me doing the whole mohair, the whole hair, because as you could imagine, it would just take far too long. So I'm just gonna video the start of the rooting, and I'll keep coming back as I'm going. So first I'll do the top of the head, then I'll do either side, and then the back. Okay, so I've got my mohair here. It's so lovely and soft. I can't say how much it's perfect. So I don't use huge amounts. Some people go and they root like with this, and then they cut it later, and then they waste it. I try not to let anything waste. I mean, the price I pay for this, I'm not gonna waste any. So anyway, I cut it to about an inch, and then obviously once I have finished the baby, I will cut it even shorter if need be. Okay, so I'll just put that up there. So I just grab it in my little fingers like that. I'll put it down first and I'll show you what I'm going to do. So with the top of the head, I'm going to work in that direction, like that, keeping my needle flat against the head, not like this. If you're doing it like this, your hairs are going to stick up like that. They're going to poke up like a little clown or a mohawk. You can wet them down, but they'll still always have that tendency to pop up. So you've got to go in on this angle, because then your hair's going to have the tendency to lie down. So I'm going to go all the way up. And if you look at the top of a baby's head, you'll notice that round oval shape like that. That's what we're going to do. Now, if you want, you can get a little pencil, like I suggest like a fabric pencil or something, and you can just draw, before you start, draw that oval line around. It'll wipe off as you're going, so it's no big deal. Don't worry about it. Use a white or something. Even some people use chalk as well. I'm not sure if I've got some in here. I'll just quickly look. No, I don't, but that's all right. I'm sure you get what I'm talking about. So the round part here. So I do it on the angle all the way up. So I'll go here, just keep doing lines and working up. And then when I get to the end, I start to to make it go to a certain direction. So if, let's say, I'm going to have the swirl, the head swirl over here, then as I'm coming up to this angle, I'll start angling my hair like this. So I started like this, and then I get like this, and I start angling my needle like that. So then I keep going like that until I get to that point. Now the swirl I'll show you next, so that's okay. So I'll just start off with this. Hopefully you can see it there. So I'm only trying to get like one or two hairs in at a time. So I've only got a single barb, so I'm having my barb pointing down. If I take more than one hair, I can always pop them out with some tweezers. So there is one little spot there where I've got too much hair in, but for the video purpose you can see it and I can just pop it out afterwards. So I'll just be working across. Now there's a lot of different ways you can hold your baby as you're doing it. Some people will have a little bowl with a nappy in it or something, or some people will have a rice sack that they sit the baby's head on. I personally normally sit on the floor and I have my knees up. You might have seen in another video, and I had the baby's head sitting just where my knees are, and then it's close to the proximity of my eyes, and I like to work like that. But everyone's different. Find the way you're comfortable and do it from there. So I'll just stop there so I can show you. So, as you can see, the little hair there. It's only tiny, very fine. So cute. Okay, so I'm going to keep going. As you do certain sections of hair, I have my little spray bottle, but as you're doing certain sections of hair, I normally give it a spray with some conditioning spray. So that's just get yourself a little spray bottle, fill it with warm water and some conditioner and shake it up until it's sort of all mixed up. And that can obviously last months. And that's what I use. I spray and I have a baby toothbrush, much better than a baby brush because it's so small. And it's not going to take a heap of hairs. So I get my baby toothbrush and I just comb that down. Otherwise, if I wasn't to do that, it would be all fly away. It'd be sitting up in the air everywhere. And it would be getting in my way of my work. So as I go, I flatten it down and it tames it. And it's easier to work with. Okay, so start off with that. If you have any questions, of course, you can ask me down below in the comments and I will get back to you. But I will come back when I'm sort of coming towards the end there so you can see what I mean about that different angle I'm working on. And then we'll go
from there. So hoping everyone's going all right with the first part of your routine. So this is Jessie so far. As you can see, that round part on the head that I spoke about earlier. And I'm working my way back. Get a closer look there. It's all very fine. Okay, so now I'm just going to show you the process I was talking about where we're going to do the swirl. So the swirl is going to be over this side. So what I'm going to do now is work my way over there and swirl around. So I'll just bring everything closer so hopefully you can see nicely. I hope it can be seen. So I've got my hair and all I'm going to do is just root in that direction. So like I said, if I get a few extra hairs in, that's okay. I can pick them out afterwards. Just going in this direction.
So you can see how I'm going there in that kind of direction. What I also do is I look at the side of the baby's head and I try to imagine where I think it would end, which is what I'm thinking there, and then I work in that direction. So I don't go past a certain point, which is normally working like that. So I'll stop it there. You can see what I'm trying to do now. And I will message, I'll video again when I get to the end part of
that. Okay, so I've got to that end part there, as you can see. I've worked from over here to over there, and this is where I want my little swirl to be. So, you'll be able to see by looking very close that. Sorry, I'm looking back to front when I'm looking at the screen. That all the hair is tendency to go, you can see it's pointing that way. That's because that is the angle that I did all of the rooting there. So when I get to that end, so I've worked my way that way, like this. Now I want to begin my swirl. But I have to change the direction of the needle when I get to this end, because we're just going in the direction of a swirl. If you could imagine, I want the swirl to go there. So I'm going to be turning my needle and the head like that. So I'm always turning the head and I'm always keeping that needle in the direction I want it to go for a swirl. So, what I'm going to do, I'm just going to give it a quick spray. As you can see, Jessie has a bit of fluffy spray type of hair at the moment. So, if I just give it a quick spray with the water and conditioner mix, I normally have a smaller bottle, but I think one of my kids nicked it. So, I use a baby toothbrush. It is the best. I've told you before, if you're using a big baby brush, number one, the whole head of the brush is too big and it'll pull out too many little hairs. This is just perfect, and the softness of it is perfect as well. So I just work in the direction that I want to comb it in the direction that I want it to go. So it was like that. So just comb it all down in that direction. See how that looks so nice. I'll comb the front down as well so you can see what that looks like. Once I've combed it once, I don't normally recomb it until I have set it in place, because I don't want to lose all my little hairs. So that's how Jessie's looking at the moment. Fix that up there. So if you want to dry that quickly, because you really want to keep going, I suggest you just hold it to your body, you know, hold it there and let your clothes absorb that little bit of moisture on the head, and you can roll it from side to side gently to dry it. When you're working with a needle and the vinyl, it doesn't seem to work very well if the head's wet. It just feels like it's going to break or something. Okay, so that should be fine for now, so I can keep showing you what I'm doing. So I'll bring that down again. You can see it all nicely there. Let's continue with this swirl. So I normally work on the outside of the swirl and then come into the inside. So let's just keep heading down, making the side the swirl. As you can see, the way I'm angling my hand is the way I want the swirl to be directioned. And all you got to do is just move the baby's head as you're going. Remember, if you get any extra hairs in, you can just get a little set of tweezers and pluck them out afterwards. Don't stress about that now. So turn the baby's head as you're going. You can see that I'm getting too many hairs in here for a little preemie baby who would be so very, very fine, but I just want yous to see. I'm hoping yous can see. I haven't really been seeing what yous are looking at. But you can see how we're getting that swirl motion there. So keep going. Keep turning baby's head and going in that direction of the turn. There's no right or wrong again with the swirl. If you want it bigger, you can do it bigger. If you want it smaller, keep it small. You can also do like a double crown, just two swirls. So just keep swirling that around. Now you'll get to a stage where there's just too much hair in the way and you'll have to give it a spray down. So we'll do that now so you can see. So seeing how that's looking, give it a spray. I love my little spray bottle because it doesn't spray like crazy all over everywhere. This is a bit too crazy. So once again, we're going to brush in the direction that the swirl's going. Remember, you're not trying to get it picture perfect at this stage. All we need to do is get it flat. So we get it flat because we want to have that room in there to work to finish it. So just drawing it off again so you can quickly see. Don't forget, it's not to look picture perfect. I'm not trying to impress you at this stage. I'm just trying to get it dry so we can finish that center part. Okay, so we'll finish this little center part. It's a little bit difficult, like I said, because it's wet. I hate working on wet vinyl, but I want to show you the finishing of this. So just keep working around in that direction you were working before. The wet hair is now allowed for me to work without all this fluff in the way, and it won't take long to finish the middle of the swirl because it's only a few hairs, and you can fill in the hairs too where you think might need more as well along the way. I think that's about it. Just got a couple more there. Okay, so you can see the center part of my swirl is now filled. So we'll always just keep brushing that in that direction. So now we go to the next part of the hair. So we want to do the sides next. Well, the top's finished. So you start just about down on the ear there. And like I always say, work like your own hair. As you can see with my hair, I've got like steps like that. And you can look at your own hair or your children's own hair, photos online, and do it any way you like. But with this little guy, what I'm probably going to do is I'm going to work up like in a little V there. And then when I get to the top of the V about there, I'm going to come back in and I'm going to angle it around. So if you can imagine, it's going to look like a question mark sort of on the side. So I start there, work all the way back, getting behind the ears and working back to here. And I do the same on the other side, then we'll do the back. So I'll just start a little bit on that side now so you can see where I'm at. Okay, so to start her off, just about, just below the ear lobe, at the top of the ear lobe. Can you
keeping your needle as well in the direction, that flat direction, not pointing, poking up like that. So I think I've gotten out far enough there in that V shape. So now I'll back it up, back it in. Don't forget, excess hairs can be pulled out. If the hairs are too long, they'll be trimmed all at the end. Okay, so hopefully you can see that that's kind of a question mark look. I want to do that on that side and the other side. So now I'm just going to work my hair all the way back to here. So it'll be in that, that's all I'm going to do, that little triangle there. I'm going to start a little bit behind the ears and work that way. So once I've done that, I'll show you again. So this is the first side finished. If you can see that all there, it's all going in that direction. And we need to work on the other side. So I'll just spray that down so you can see what it should be like. Coming around the back of the ears there. Coming forward to the front. Like that. Just fix that swirl up a bit there. Haven't laid that down properly. So there we go. Just fine. Ultra fine. And then at the end we'll trim all those edges. Okay, so now work on the next side. And then we'll do the back. And then we're done. I think that side, because this baby is so tiny, took me about 5 minutes. So... and then, like I said, at the end, I come back and just sort of trim it all up and get it all perfect. Okay. Done the two sides. We've done the top and we've done the swirl. So now we just start on the bottom. So when you've done the sides, you should have done behind the ears. Sometimes I haven't done it on that side, but sometimes it can be really difficult because you're trying to get in there without breaking your needle and without having it on too much of an angle. You can normally go up behind the ear like that and get in, and it will work. Okay, so with the bottom, it's just as simple as the rest. Try to work in some kind of direction as you go. So I would start at the bottom. I've got a hair on there. At the bottom, and I would just simply go directly across the bottom in a straight line. See those hairs? So then as you work up, you can change the angle direction of your tool. So let's say I've done that a little bit. And I was over here on this side, I would go in a different direction, like that. So instead of just going straight like this, I'll now be angling it that way. So, and sometimes it's just a matter of not angling the tool, but angling the head in that direction. So if I was to angle, hopefully you can see there. First, angle the head towards me in this direction, then I can still put the tool in and it feels like I'm just going in that straight angle. So I would do it up this way, so going around, so it works into that swirl. This hair here, which originally started like this, I'll now be working around, this will be working into it, this part will be going around like this. So it then all works into one, not a massive swirl, but when you comb it, you can see that it all is directional. So once that back part is done, then we just have to do the eyelashes. So do the back part now and then come back.
Okay, see you soon. Sorry. Okay, so here is little Jesse. All his hair has finished. I haven't skewered into place yet. So what I did when I finished it, there was a couple of bald spots. Occasionally you will get them because there is some rubbing, and this is just so hard to hold to keep it from getting those little bald spots. Normally with the bigger heads, you've got more of a face to hold and stop it from rubbing anywhere. So you can see it's all done. It's yet to be obviously secured, trimmed, and all that sort of thing. I did mention earlier how if I had any plugs that I had too much hair in, that I would tweezer them out at the end. But I'm not going to do that with this guy because his hair is pretty fine as it is. And I just think over time when the customer gets it and they're lightly brushing it, it'll just give it more room for it getting less thin with the hair brushing. Even though it's secured in place, you still will lose hairs from time to time. So anyway, now we've got to do the eyelashes. Eyelashes are really, really easy, so don't be afraid of them. And just remember, I think eyelashes are easier than doing any of the hair, so don't go and purchase eyelashes and glue them in. I suggest to root them. It's much more realistic. So you've got a guideline there already with the eye slit. So literally, just get your needle and just put your hair there and put it in. And see that little fine hair there? So do that all the way across the line. This is definitely, if you get too thick eyelashes, as you can imagine, Preemies either have very short eyelashes or none at all. So, and they're definitely not thick and flourishing. Well, I'm sure actually there's probably some, but generally I'm speaking. So if you do have any thick hairs, like I've got one here, I'll show you in a minute, I would definitely recommend to tweezer that one out. So you can see towards the middle there, I have a thick plug. That one I will definitely be plugging out. So you can see the difference there. Obviously, we're still yet to trim it. So I'll do the other side as well, because it's so quick to do. This is probably one of my, I think is the most funnest part, because you're getting towards the end of the kit and you've got this guide here, and you know that the mohair goes in really easily. I say as it didn't go in easily. And anyway, and then it sort of brings that baby to life so much more. Nearly there. Okay, so there we go. So what I would normally do now is just get my little spray bottle and spray across those eyelashes and just gently pat them down. They're already in that direction where they're going to sit down, but wetting them and letting them dry in that direction will just kind of set them. So the next part of our journey is to seal all of that mohair with the glue inside the head. And if baby needs a dummy, we need to put a magnet inside there as well. So that's the next step. Get your glue ready and we'll keep going.
Okay, so how exciting. We are now up to the gluing process, and for me, tomorrow baby Jessie will be born. So here he is, just like you left him last time. I haven't done anything else with him. I'm just going to do the gluing. I haven't brushed his hair anymore. I don't want to pull any fine hairs out or anything. I haven't cut his little eyelashes yet either. So we're going to start with all the gluing process. So first I need a few things. I need black felt. This goes just behind the nose because I have drilled out his nose, so it just gives that bit of depth. I've got his dummy, I've got the glue, and my tools. So first I'll start with the black felt. So I just cut a small square, which is going to go behind his nose. And I've got here gel bond glue. I get it from Bunnings. I get it because it's a contact adhesive. It's heat and water resistant, and it's a strong instant bond. I use it because of the factor that it's heat and water resistant. So in Australia, we can get pretty hot, and you know, I just don't know how other glues might cope with the weather and everything. So I think of those sort of things, and also the water resistant, because people are going to be brushing their hair, and I just think I want it to be, I don't want, you know, mold to be in the head or anything like that. I've used this for years and years and I've never had any problems. I've had times where I've had to get babies back and not do anything with their head, but maybe I've had to do other things with them. People want a different body or something, and I've noticed that inside everything is still nice and secured, and no hair has come out or anything. So I think it's pretty good. So anyway, I've opened the can. It is a yellow consistency color. Oops, my magnets just stuck to the lid there. So I've just got a regular paddle pop stick, and I'm just going to like paste a little bit onto that black felt. You can use other color felts. I used to use like a pink and everything, but I found in the end that the black was the only one that gave it that depth, which made it look like my nose, like it keeps going, you know, like, so I suggest that. So anyway, with that, I'm just going to put it in there. I've got, it's such a tiny hole, so it's going to be hard, but we're doing it. Put it in there. Now, I just put that little bit of paste on just so it sort of sticks into place. It's obviously much easier to see with bigger babies. You can then see the black. Before I go too far, I'm just going to get a little bit of paste on my stick, and I'm going to actually glue the back of the eyelashes, because there's not much room there. I want to make sure that there's glue on the back of the eyelashes, so this little piece of black felt doesn't sit in the way of that happening. I want to make sure that they're secured. I'm never stingy on the glue. I put way too much, if anything. I think that's the best way to go. Sorry about the eye closing, but it's so tiny there. Something else I do suggest for these incidents is a headlamp. Now, I'm not going to use it now because I've got great light in here, but normally I've got my headlamp, pop it on. I sell them in Aussie Reborn Supplies anyway, and I think this one's dead at the moment. Oh no, it's not. So I can bend that if it's tight on my head. I haven't got it at the moment, and I can look into the head, especially if it's a bigger head. I can see everything. I can glue at night. Even sometimes I can do like hair rooting and painting at night with it, but I prefer still to use the daylight, but I have done before when I have needed to. So anyway, I'm just going to make sure that black felt is behind the nose. It seems to be doing its own little thing at the moment, and like I said, it's so hard to see. I think I got it. Show me the black felt. Yeah, there we go. Okay, can't really see, but it is in there. Yeah, you can see that. Okay. So next thing I do is I've got my dummy. So I have got a general. Let me just pick this up. I think I put it over here. Now here it is. With all my babies that I ever make, I have a in-store dummy, which never leaves here. That is because all my babies that I sell, I want to have the same magnet direction. That way, if any of my customers say that they want more dummies, I know exactly what direction to make their dummies in. I think it's very important. Okay, so I'm going to put a magnet, just drop a magnet inside the head. Just drop it in there, and then I'm going to put my dummy there. Now, where are you, magnet? Come down here. There we go. So, of course, I'm not going to use that big dummy. I have got a Honeybug Preemie dummy. Once again, something I sell through Aussie Reborn Supplies. So, I don't know if you can see that little busy bee. There's a little picture of a bee. Well, like an emblem of a bee there. So I just put my dummy and my magnet in the back. In the back of that dummy, just like that. Now I'm going to put his head down so the magnet stays in that direction. And put the Honeybug one there. Okay, so it sits. Once again, this is highly recommended. If you're making babies to sell, have a directional dummy that's in place that always stays in your store so your customers can come and buy one off you and you'll send it out knowing that it's getting the right direction. So that is all killed. The Honeybug Preemie dummies. They're very tiny and perfect for, his little promise kit is tiny, as you can see, so it fits quite nicely. Okay, so the next thing I do with that is I need to glue that magnet in place. So I just get my stick again, put the paste on it, nice quite big amount, and I'm going to put that in the head. Now it's already starting to drip off, and let it drip directly on to the magnet, and I try to get as much around that magnet as I can. Once again, this is really difficult. I cannot see in. I've just thought about another problem I'm about to come to. So anyway, most of this glue, unfortunately, due to the size of the head, is just dripping in and around that magnet. Now normally, when I'm creating my... that stick just dropped. When I'm creating the babies, I use this. Now this is a hemostat. And you may think, ew, that is all my glue stuck on it. Originally, when I got this, I think this was a 10-inch. I also sell 8-inch and 6-inch. But originally when I got this, obviously it was clean, and I used to clean the glue off after every gluing, but after some of not cleaning off properly, it's glued up. Very pretty. So anyway, with the hemostats, you would unclamp that. You would get like your cosmetic wedge or something similar. Put it in the end and reclamp that. It's just like a hospital item. It holds it into place. Then I would dip that in my glue, and then I dip it straight into the head and swirl and brush around so I'm completely coating the inside. But with Mr. Jesse here, this is going to be completely different. I cannot get that into there and be happy. So it's going to be all paste, dripping paste, and hoping it gets into place properly. I could probably get a paintbrush and stick it in that hole and rub it around, but I'm not going to do that. I'm just going to do it this way. It is working not too bad. I feel the paint painting onto the inside of him, but I'm going to make sure I'm clear with that by putting a lot of glue in. Yeah, it's, I can feel it pacing the outside. You might even be able to see that the head is moving from where I'm rubbing it on. So basically, that is the gluing process. I'll finish here because I think you know how to glue. I then leave it. I leave it for 24 hours, longer sometimes, but and sometimes I've done it shorter. Sometimes I've glued it in the morning and put it in the afternoon, because when you do put those products inside your little weight bag and your polyfill, there is still a little bit of tackiness left there from the glue, and so that works all as part of the bond. You know, it'll bond whatever you've just put in the bag. It'll bond to that glue and can make an extra securing, especially if you don't have someone tampering with it and pulling it out. If someone does tamper with it and pulls out the bag, you know, they might pull out hair. Well, it would be pretty hard with this glue anyway, but so that's it. So tomorrow, which will be for you in one moment, I'm going to have the process of putting Jessie together. Gee, it's going to be late at night. It's going to be late anyway because little Jessie is going to be born at about 10:26 at night, I believe it was. But I might put him together during the day and then do the last zip tie cut late at night when he's to be born. Okay, so see you in a minute. Okay, so I'm just going to start putting little Jessie together. So I've got his two legs here. Now, for the limbs, I always like to put in fine glass bead. So that's the one that's very fine. It's like thinner than sand almost. I like that because when I put it into the limbs, it gives them like a muscle tone. Like if you go for the tumble glass or the coarse glass bead, it gives it like a crunch when you squeeze it. But with this, it just gives a soft tone, like muscles, our own muscles. So I filled it all the way up to the top in there, and then I put a 20 millimeter plug in there. So they're my two legs, and now I'll do the arms. With the arms, I won't be able to put plugs in, unfortunately, because they're so teeny tiny. So I'll just fill them up. So I've just got a little container here that I pour in. Actually, what I'm going to do is, I've got a little funnel here. So I'm going to put that little funnel in his limbs and fill that up. That'll be much better. Oh, and it's still, that didn't work really well, I think, because there's not much room in there at all. It's already full. Wow. I just want to get some down into there. Doesn't feel, oh yep, there we go. There's some in the hands there. Okay. So then I'll go about and fill the other one. That's good. So I'm just sort of pushing that fine glass bead to make sure it goes all the way through there. Let's do that one again with the other one. Okay, I might get a little tiny bit out of that. Okay, so what I'm going to do, because I can't have plugs, I've just got my cosmetic wedge. I'm just going to tear the edge off that and see if I can tear that in half again. Okay, so I've only got it filled up to about here, and then I'm going to stuff that cosmetic wedge in there. just so those glass beads stay in place. And the other one. And again, pop that in there. Nice and easy. Great. So I've got my limbs filled, and now I've got the little body. Thomas, I've got my zip ties. So I'll just show you the card that comes with Promise, so that will go home with Jessie. And then the teeny tiny body to match is so cute. So with the zip ties, like you do with any other body, I'm going to feed the zip ties into the hole. Feed that around. Seems a little bit more hard when the body's so little. So perfect. So I have to edge that as I go. I have to bend it in the direction so that the zip tie will just flow through. Otherwise it tends to get stuck. Gotta take your time on these things. Okay, like that. So I'll do that with all of them. Hopefully won't take too long. Thanks for being patient. Could have done this earlier, but there is some people that like to see it happening and are still unsure. They get stuck. So like I said, just keeping the angle of that so we can feed the cable tie in, because it gets stuck. It's very fiddly. Okay, so we've got another one through. Okay, so I'm going to just I might just put the legs on now so you can see. So you can tell that's the front of the body, so make sure that you're putting the legs on the right side. And I'm just going to put it into the hole, and so it's sitting around that leg there. Once again, that's a tight hole. There we go. So as you can see, it's just like that. I'll put the other one on before I zip tie them up. You can do it one at a time, but I'm just going to do that. So what you want to do before you zip tie them up is make sure that the feet are on the right side, the legs are on the right side, and that the angle's right. So you want to make sure, like with these ones, they're not really going to rotate very much, so I want to know that I've got it in a good angle for life. So then just pop, feed the zip tie into its locking mechanism and pull shut, and do that on both sides. Now what I'm going to do, so there is still just a little bit of movement, I'm not going to do it too tight. Just tight enough that hopes to keep them on at this stage. So there we go, there's the legs. So I'll put the arms on too. Once again. Always make sure too that your cable tie, this part is facing out. Because then when you feed it like that, it's not like that. And back to front, so you can't make it work. So feed that through there. Tiny, tiny hole. Ooh. It's working okay. It's ever so tiny. And the other side.
Okay, and then there's one more which will go in the head. May as well do that now while we're here. Hopefully you're working alongside me anyway, and doing your own cable ties. Sometimes if there's a seam like halfway, like this one, sometimes the cable ties, if the seam is on the inside, sometimes they get stuck, and you'll find then you'll have to pull out the cable tie and go in the other way. That always works for me anyway. So nearly there. There we go. So I'll put the arms on now, once again making sure they're on the right side. And I'm gonna lock that one into place. Just make sure it's angled the way you want it. I normally have it angled so the arm will just sit nicely on the baby's belly, the little hand. So I'm gonna lock that into place. And then let's do the other side. I'll just feed that into the lock there. Get the arm and put it in place, making sure once again it's in a good angle position. I'm not going to make too tight, so hopefully, oh no, it's not really much rotating there. Oh, sorry Jesse. So there we go. So the next step is we're going to fill the baby with some weight. So get your polyfill and get your weight, what you're using. Like I said, I don't use fine glass for inside the body or inside the head. I actually use coarse glass bead. I think it works best. So just grab that and we'll get, I also need a stocking for putting your glass bead in. Okay, so today's the day that I get to put Jessie together. So like we've, body's all ready and we want to put the head on and put the weight and everything now. So before I do that, I just want to give him that trim that he needs. As you can see, his eyelashes are a bit overgrown. So with that, I've got these little shears. Now, I highly recommend these for any reborn artist. Big scissors or barber scissors are always too big. These are perfect one-handed and you just can easily get in there without just... It's just 10 times easier than any pair of scissors. So, for that, just get up a little bit closer so you can see. So I just need to trim those eyelashes to a more respectable, natural length. These are really good too for getting in those corners. I find like even when you have a little pair of nail scissors, they just don't get into that little spot in the corner. Now, even though I've glued these, I can still pluck out some little hairs if I had to by tugging them a little bit extra. So there you can see that eyelash is a little bit better, but you can see there's like one little black part there that's a little bit too much. So I might have to pull that out. So once again, the same on the other side. That's great. So you can see there's a thick hair there as well. So I want to remove that. So just trim them down. I won't trim them all the way while you're there watching. So anyway, then with the hair, once again, just I pull it all out to a good level and trim it all the way around. Just needs to be, see, get that out, and there's some flyaway hairs there that are a little bit too much. Trying to keep them all on the same level. Now, of course, this little baby was a preemie and didn't have, like, thick, long hair. Just trying to find my, there it is, my little toothbrush that I always use.
Yeah, so he didn't have like lots of long thick hair, so I'm going to try to trim that down quite substantially. So it's more realistic. So just go around. See, I'll trim that down. You can see that it's coming shorter there. Okay. So just trim it all the way around, nice and neat. Around the back of the head particularly, you want it to be straight along there. So see what I'm doing. So that's a bit better than once again. So normally work around the back of the head, this front section, just trim it nice and even, shorter like that, and then the front top of the head. Trim that too. So as long as the back, the sides, and the top are all trimmed nice and even, then you can come along and make all those long bits shorter. I only want to have them to be about half a centimeter long. Like that. See, that's really short. Great. So go ahead and do that, and then we'll put him all together.
Okay, so it's time to give this baby some weight. So I've got my little scales here. I use these typically because they're just easy going. I do have the baby scales, but especially with this little baby, he's too tiny. So I'm just going to put him on there like that, and his head. So this is without the weight. So that's just over 200 grams, so almost about 250, and this baby has to be 740 grams. That was his birth weight, and that's what the customer has asked for. So to start with, I'm just going to put a little bit of polyfill into his bottom. So get that down in there. Just fill out his bottom a little bit with the polyfill. Just so it gives that nice little soft feeling. Then I've just got like a regular pair of women's stockings. And I'll just cut an end off there. And I'll just tie a knot because I've used it a few times. I don't have the foot part at the moment. So just tie a knot there. Very simple. Nice and tight. Okay. So I've got my weight. Got my weight in here. Now for inside the body and the head, I use coarse glass bead. If you can see that, it is like little beads, little glass beads, all a little bit round. I find it the best. It doesn't come through the stocking or anything. So I'm going to just put the stocking inside his body there and just have the opening coming out like that. Normally I'd be doing this on a table, but I'm going to hold him up so everyone can see properly. So then I just pour the glass bead into that stocking. I'll just put that in so he goes in the right direction. So I don't know if I'm going to be able to actually get this baby up to 740 grams, because that means I have to put
400 grams, which is, if you think about it, about the size of a butter, you know. So I'll see as far as I can go with him without making him feel horrible. We've got to remember when we're putting in this weight, if a customer is asking for a certain weight, that this is not a realistic weight. It's a dead weight. So the baby might have been born at 740 grams, but as a dead weight, it would be heavier. When we're born, we're holding our muscle tone to some kind of degree. We're not just lying, well, we are lying there floppy, but we still are able to lift our arms and things like that, which is holding your own weight. So I'll see how I can go though. I feel so good. And that's what I want him to feel. I don't want him to feel all squished and hard. That's just not the feeling you want to get from these little babies. Okay, he's just about full enough. Like, just feels really great there. I think any more is going to feel yuck. So I'll just see what that weighs. See, that's 400. I'm not going to get another 300 grams in his head. But we'll see how we can go. I can fit a little bit more in there, tiny bit. Now, just I also put in all of my babies, I have a powder wafer that I put in. I highly recommend it. I always find when my babies go out, they smell like baby powder, and I often get comments how they smell so realistic. So don't cut corners. I think they're 50 cents. Well, I sell them. I sell 10 for $5.20, and that's posted. So just half of that I put into the, this is half I put into the body and half I put in behind the nose. Especially with the, I have the, nose open, so I feel like it can come out through that nose. Let's pop that in there, and I'll just put a little bit more weight in there, just a little bit. Yep, still going good. I can still put a little bit more. Little Jesse, like I said, is going to be born tonight. Well, at the moment it's about 8:30 in the morning. He's going to be born tonight at 10:26, so that's why I'm just putting them all together. I'll have him born tonight, which is the last cable tie cut tonight at 10:26. Then I have to put him all together because I have to deliver him tomorrow tomorrow morning to his home. That I've been lucky, my customer lives close by me, and I'm going to deliver him tomorrow morning before this actual little baby's first birthday. So this time last year, she was getting ready to have her son. Ah, now I've dropped some of that. Now he feels really good. He is very solid, but the glass bead is making him really feel nice there. So I think I can manage that. Take that. Speed out of there. So I've just got that. I'm going to tie that off now so no more glass bead can escape. I normally would put a little bit more polyfill in there, but there's just no room. So he might look very solid to you, but as you can see, he is really, really nice and squishy. He feels good. Okay. So that's his body done. So we'll do his head. I've finished all the trimming as much as I can at this stage. I'll do a little bit more at the end and do that plucking as well. Okay, so pretty tight in there. Gonna get another piece of stocking. Tie that in the end.
Now with that powder wafer, I'm going to put that directly in behind his nose, which, yes, is difficult because it's so tiny. So I've just sort of folded it up in there, push it in. And if I can just make sure it goes, yep, behind the nose there. Ah, that is good. So that's fine. So put this end into his head. Okay. This is going to be hard. It's so tiny. There's not much room to work. Here goes. Going to be a slow process, I think. But it's getting there. So little by little. So you know what I'm doing, so I might stop it again, and once I have it filled and to wait, I will video again so you can watch me put the neck ring on and the plug. Okay, so I have got it up to the 740 grams. The head's a little bit heavy, but I think it does work in with the body okay. So I'm just going to tie this off like that and just pop that in there. Couple of little glass beads on his hair. So I'm just going to grab a little bit of polyfill. This one won't need much. He's already quite filled with that weight bag. So just poke it all in. You'll be surprised how much polyfill you can get in these babies. Okay. Okay. So that's pretty good. And then I got a plug. Not that one, the 16 mil, like that, and the neck ring. So I've got a little 40 millimeter neck ring here. I think it's a little tiny bit big, but it'll work. I might take the plug out for now. So with the neck ring, it goes like this. So I'll just pop that in there, and this just helps the neck rotate. Highly recommend a neck ring. If you don't have a neck ring and you pull the cable ties too hard and everything, it just will sit there. It won't let you turn the head. So just popping the base of the neck out so it can sit there good. Okay. So there we go, and we'll just pop that plug in there. So now we just get the body. I'm just going to feed that cable tie through. And we're ready to put the head on. Poke everything in there. I'm not going to put any polyfill in this one because I want him to be able to be squished as much as he can. Once this goes in, that's a lot of room it takes up. So I'm just put that weight back on my leg so we can stand it up, sit him there, and just putting the head on top of that body. Such a small hole. Just turn it in there and it will come in
Okay, there we go. So it just popped in. Oh, he's so cute. Oh my gosh. Okay, so I'm going to just pull that cable tie tight now, and you will see I can turn his head. No problems. Wow, he is heavy, but he looks great, doesn't he? So now I'm just going to, tonight's when I cut all the cable ties. So just for now, that's little Jesse. Got some fluff in his hair. So I'll video tonight once I'm doing all the cable ties. You can, I only say he's born on the last cable tie cut, so I can cut those. So I just got to make sure the leg is in the position I want it to be, and then just give that cable tie another pull. And to cut, I cut down in a V, so down there and there with my scalpel. So cut down into the middle, and on the other side cut down into the middle. This is really important. Number one, the don't forget the scalpel. If you've got it, it's quite sharp. But if you don't do that, you'll have a little bit of a cable tie bit poking out there, and it can be quite sharp and can scratch you. So just cut there again, down and down. Here we go, so there's the bottom ones are cut, and they feel nice and unscratchy. He's so beautiful. Alright, so I'll cut the other ones later, but I'll video in tonight for the last assembly part. Okay, so I thought I'd quickly come back. I've just trimmed little Jesse's eyelashes, so they're barely there now. And now I'm just giving him a like a gloss finish to his lips and nails. This is optional, you might not want to do it. I've already just put some gloss on his lips there. You can see that they're slightly shiny. So I just use personal Dimensional Magic 3-dimensional Royal Coat. We used to use air dry gloss, but they don't actually make the air dry gloss anymore. So now I found that the Dimensional Magic was quite good. It's not too overbearing, and it just looks nice. So just go ahead and paint on all your fingernails, toenails, and lips. You can put it in the little bit in the inside of the eyes, or just in the nose a little bit. Just gives it that little bit of a wet look. It's not really an important step, but if you want to do it, you can go ahead and do it now before we start dressing baby. He's cute, hey. Okay everyone, so it's time to put baby Jesse together. He's all sitting here patiently waiting. So I'll just, before the time sort of comes up, I'm just keeping an eye on the time. I've created a little birth certificate for Jesse. As you can see, we've got his name, who he's born to, that he's born at Miracle Babies Newborn Nursery on the 29th of the 5th, 15, 740 grams, he's male, it's 30 centimetres, and the signature there, my signature. So anyway, that'll go in the box at the end. This is all going to go in here. Just checking the time again. Okay, almost time. So I might just grab him out of there. He's looking so cute. Really happy with him. Hopefully the picture isn't too grainy, but it is at night in my garage, so I'm doing the best I can. And after this anyway, you'll see all the pictures of him. So I better just get my little scalpel to cut that last little bit. Okay, that's good, great. One moment. So anyway, just before I cut that, which is in a moment, on all my babies I put a little tag at the back. Hopefully you can see that. That says Miracle Babies Newborn Nursery, my own tag to say, you know, that he's one of my creations. I think if he goes out into the world, it's always nice to know who was the creator. Okay, and it's time. So just with the scalpel like I did before, cutting down in that V motion. Just like that. It's always hard to do these things one-handed, isn't it? Put my paint down there. Because you don't want to cut the kit either. You want to get a nice clean cut. There we go. Make sure there's no sharp bits. There's a tiny sharp bit there, so I just trim that. Great, there we go. So he's all born. And that's it. So now it's just about dressing him. I'll just get this over here. Hopefully you can see him all really well there as I dress him. So like every baby, he needs a nappy. I've got a little Preemie size nappy here to put on him. Pop his little bottom on there. So cute. So tiny too. Look at that. So he's got his little nappy on now. And I've got a little nappy cover. It's like a mint green colour with that print on the inside. Pop that over that nappy. Like that. Beautiful. So cute. Okay, so then he's got an outfit. So here's his little outfit. Blue and white checks with the elephant on the front and the matching hat. Now the nappy cover, the outfit and hat and the booties were all created by Mini Creations. That's Creations with a K, and I can highly recommend her little Preemie outfits. They're just so perfect. They fit perfectly. They look great. No more trying to dress a little Preemie baby in a 5-0 outfit that still doesn't fit anywhere near. So she's on Facebook, so look her up wherever you are. I'm sure she sends internationally as well. So look at that, it's just perfect. Just perfect. So I'll put on his little hat as well. Oh my goodness, it's just perfect. I did pop this on earlier today, so I kind of already know what it looks like, but before I did the little last cut, as you just saw, because I had to get his photography done, as it's 10:26 at night now, 10:30 or so, and I have to deliver him in the morning, so I needed to have everything ready. So he still wasn't born as I didn't cut the cable tie, but I had to do the photography session. So look at that, that's just perfect. He is perfect. And he comes with a dummy. There's his little dummy, one of the Honeybug Preemie dummies. So he needs now a hospital tag, so I'll just put that around his teeny tiny legs. Oh no, you know what? Doesn't fit. Well, let's have a see if I can get it to fit. It just fit. It's going to be loose. Wow. You know, you don't think about these things when you know, you haven't dealt with a real Preemie before. Look at that, it's just loose. So cute. So I'll just cut that away,
that excess amount. Okay, so now to package him all up, I'll put him back in the little basket over there. He can watch what everyone's doing. So like I said before, I've got the box. And this is because it's his birthday, of course. So I'll just put everything in there. It's got a blue blanket. Pop that in there. Now I did some photography with this little teddy, so I thought I would send it anyway because the real Jessie turns one today, and although it's one of my favourite little bears, little teddies, I just think it should go home with him. So I'm just going to pop that up there like that. Let's see if I can move this all down. Pop this up there so you can see. So I'm going to put Jessie in there now because I need everything to go around him. So I'm going to make out like that teddy is a bit of his pillow. Jessie does have his own teddy, and this is this teeny tiny teddy here, and it's got May on it since he was born in May. So I'll put that in his arms like that. And then I've got a disposable change mat. So although these things are just gimmick type of things, they're going to work out perfect for this baby because he's still a baby. She can put that in her own baby bag. I've got a Huggies Preemie nappy here. Although it is still too big for little baby Jessie, she could still use it on him. It still works. He's got a blue brush and comb set. I hope all this isn't too glary. I apologize that it is. So I'm just going to put that to the side there. I've got the Elmo baby wipes. Once again, she'll be able to use this in Jessie's baby bag. We've got our powder. I've got some earbuds, cotton tips. I always send them out because they're always really good for when you've got a clean baby, just as a light dusting option. I've got a little ducky, which is bubble bath. Again, just another gimmick, but perfect for the little boy. I got this one, which is baby in car smelly. It smells like baby powder, so it will give the box a scented smell like baby powder, but also she can use it in her own car for baby Jessie. Then I have a chocolate or lollipop, and it says it's a boy. These are really cute. I don't always get them in stock, but I try to send them out as much as I can. So that's pretty cute. In that goes. Then he's just got all of his cards and everything. So I'll just put that there. Probably going to pop him out and show you again because he's just so cute. So this is the photo card I made for Jessie. So his name on it, Jesse David James Perios. And the date of birth, the 29th of May 2015 at 10:26 p.m. 740 grams and 30 centimeters long. So that's her photo card. She'll be able to keep off all the pictures of Jessie, which if you keep watching this, you'll see the photos come across screen. She'll have her care instructions of how to care for baby Jessie and the birth certificate that I showed you before. So they'll all go in there as well. I'll just put that in there. I'll probably put a little bit of bubble wrap over there. And then I've got to deliver him in the morning, and that's him all done. So thanks everyone for watching this whole tutorial. I hope it has been helpful, and I know it's been very long, but
Hopefully you can come back and watch whenever you like, and it'll always be helpful for you. Don't forget to leave any messages below if you have any questions about anything during the process of creating Jessie. I'm always very happy to help anyone with their questions. So once again, thanks for watching. I hope to make some more of these tutorials, as long as they are, but I do hope to make some more. Thanks everyone. Bye.